Hello and welcome to another edition of the Hispanic Hour, La Hora Hispana. I'm your host, Tony Prado. With me is my lovely co-host, India Colon, and I am pleased to welcome to the NCCTV studio none other than Maria Matos. She's the president and CEO of the Latin American Community Center in Wilmington. It's great to finally have you here. India, por favor, take it away.
Yeah, bienvenido a otro segmento de NCCTV bajo el condado de Newcastle, Thomas P. Gordon. Aquí tenemos a Antonio y tenemos a María Matos del Centro Latinoamericano con este nuevo segmento de Hora Hispana.
Muchas gracias. So we like to start out, as if, nobody in the world knows, in case they've been hiding under a rock for the last 20 years.
Yeah, like they didn't know about.
Please tell us a little bit about yourself, where you're from, where you live now.
We like to ask where people's cultural backgrounds are from. So tell us a little bit about
that.
Well,
you gotta know. You know how Latinos are, you know?
I mean, I was born in Puerto Rico in the 1950s. I was born very poor. So in the 1950s in Puerto Rico, you had the wealthy and the poor. We were the poor. As a matter of fact, I was born in a hut with a mud floor and a straw roof. That's how poor we were. When we came here, my father came here around 1953, looking for, like everybody else, a better life. And he landed in Burlington, New Jersey, in the Burlington Mills, where they dyed fabric. And then in 1955, he sent for his three kids and his wife. And that's how we got to Burlington, New Jersey. Then we moved to Cherry Hill, New Jersey. And finally, he found a better job in Camden, New Jersey. And in Camden, my mom never worked because she was home with the kids. By this time, she had maybe four or five kids. They had 13 kids in all, and poor. I used to fight with them all the time. You know, how can you continue to have babies if you can't afford the ones you have? I was very feisty, even back then. But I remember in Camden, New Jersey, when we were living in an apartment upstairs and there was a Pentecostal family in the first floor, and I had asthma. So she asked my mom if she could take me to church because there was a healer that was coming, and he healed me. And my mom and dad converted to, we were Catholics, and they converted to Pentecostal. And my father went to the institute, and he became a minister. So in 1964, the Lord called him to Wilmington to open the first Hispanic Pentecostal church in the state of Delaware. And that's how we got to Delaware.
Bueno, María Matos está explicando sobre la cultura de ella, de dónde ha llegado ella. María Matos es ejecutiva del Centro Latino. Y háblanos un poquito en español, de dónde llegaste, de dónde vienes.
Bueno, yo nací en Puerto Rico en el 1950. Mi papá se vino para los Estados Unidos como en el 1953 para buscar un mejor trabajo y mejor vida para la familia, porque éramos bien pobrecitos. Y consiguió trabajo en Burlington, en New Jersey, y de ahí entonces mandó a buscar a mami y a tres de los niños que estábamos en Puerto Rico. Y de ahí nos mudamos para Cherry Hill y después nos mudamos para Camden. En Camden ellos se pusieron en contacto con la iglesia pentecostal, el Señor me sanó, ellos se convirtieron. Y en el 1964, el Señor llamó a papi aquí a los Estados Unidos, a Wilmington, Delaware, para que abriera la primera iglesia pentecostal. Y hemos estado en Delaware desde ese entonces.
Wow. That is a long time aquí en la comunidad.
50 años y pico.
50 años y pico.
Yo tenía 14 años, imagínate.
Directamente de Puerto Rico.
No, directamente de Cherry Hill, New Jersey.
Cherry Hill, New Jersey. Wow. Bueno, háblanos un poquito sobre. I know, qué historia.
Yeah, and how long have you been serving, everyone here in Delaware as the, president and CEO of, the Latin American Community Center, the Centro Latino?
Yo solamente llego ahí, llevo como, solamente como 22 años.
Ella dice, solo 22 años. 22 años como la directora ejecutiva del Centro Latino. 22 años. Oh my God.
Cuando yo cogí el Centro Latino en el 1994, nosotros tenemos una propuesta de $8,860. Hoy la propuesta es como 5 millones. Y los diferentes programas son completamente diferentes de lo que tomé en el 94, pero todavía tenemos aquellos programas que son muy beneficiosos y muy necesarios para la comunidad.
So let's say that again in English so that our other community can hear us.
Yeah, so our English speakers.
Yeah, so how long have you been with this?
Well, I've only been with the center 22 years. I've only been there 22 years.
And was that all as president?
Yes, okay. I came on board as president and CEO, as executive director, really.
Yes.
And I came from the Girl Scouts, and everything I learned at the Girl Scouts.
Which you actually have the Girl Scout programs come to the LACC.
Absolutely.
Which we'll talk about a little
Girl
bit.
Girl Scouts build character. They do. They build character. And the Boy Scouts do, too. They build character. When I took the Latin Center 22 years ago, there was a budget of about $860,000. Today, we have over $5 million. We still have some key programs that the community still needs, like ESL, English as a Second Language, and the support family support services programs. But we've increased in the quality of programs that we offer, and we've increased not only in the budget, but also in the number of people we served and the programs that we have implemented.
Hablando de eso, you know, ¿cuál es la misión de Centro Latino?
Okay, la misión del Centro Latino es proveer la capacidad a la comunidad latina a través de la educación, promoción, alianzas y servicios especiales, excepcionales. So the mission is to empower the Latino community through education, advocacy, partnerships, and exceptional services.
Wow.
That's our mission.
And with the mission, there's always core values, right?
Yes.
So with the mission, talk a little bit about what your core values for the LACC are.
Well, we have six core values. One is accountability, because you have to, people have to hold themselves accountable, and we have to have accountability, because we are stewards of other people's funds. Those are not our monies. That is not our community center. So we have to have accountability. Que son rendiciones de cuentas. O sea, tiene que rendir cuentas a la comunidad y al Estado. También tenemos dignidad, dignity and respect, dignidad y respeto, porque todo el mundo se merece dignidad y se merece respeto. También tenemos excelencia, excellence. Excellence is one of our core values. Porque if you settle for good, then you will always be good. Si estás bien con bueno, okay, pero excelencia, hay una diferencia entre okay, bueno, y excelencia. Excelencia es lo más extremo. So uno siempre tiene que tener esa meta de llegar más allá de lo que puedes llegar. So, también empowerment, so you empower the community. Le da a la comunidad el poder ser lo que ellos quieran ser. También tenemos, I got it written down, porque mi hijo, esta cabeza mía después de la edad.
Bueno, los valores del Centro Latino es el pilar de la comunidad.
Exactamente. Entonces, tenemos dos más. Integridad y pasión. Passion,
you have to have passion.
So those are our core values. And when we interview people, we ask them, you know, what's your passion? What are you passionate about? Because you have to be passionate about people, about kids, about a community, whether it's the African American community or the Latino community or the Anglo community. And kids, you have to be passionate about kids. If you're not passionate, the center is not the place for you to work.
Y bueno, y estás hablando de diferentes grupos de los afroamericanos, los americanos, los hispanos, que hay una variedad en la comunidad de Wilmington, no solo hay latinos, pero el centro dice Latin American Community Center. So hay mucha confusión a veces sobre si ese centro es dedicado solamente a los latinos. Habla sobre eso un poquito y si los servicios son primariamente para los hispanos, si está abierto para la comunidad que están ahí normalmente, que no sean hispanos.
Esa es una buena pregunta, porque yo llevo tantos años ahí. Esa es una muchas de las preguntas que siempre las personas me hacen. ¿Ustedes le sirven a otros comunidades que no sean latinas. Y la contestación es sí. Primero que nada, nosotros no podemos discriminar.
Claro
que es
no.
En contra de la ley federal. Sí. Y nosotros recibimos fondos federales. So ahí tú no puedes discriminar. Más, somos humanos. Somos humanos. La misión del centro es servir a la comunidad latina. Pero eso no quita de servir al resto de la comunidad. Porque una de las cosas que sucede en nuestra comunidad hoy en día es que las comunidades están mezcladas. En mi familia tenemos latinos, anglos y afroamericanos. Tú ves uno de mis sobrinos y no piensa que este muchacho es mitad latino. So no podemos discriminar. Y yo también pienso, the communities have mixed, they have intermarried. You have, in my family alone, when you stand with my 7 brothers and sisters, we have African Americans, we have Anglos, and
speaking
that is
of that, you know, like India was asking you in Espanol, some people might wonder, is the Latin American Community Center just for Hispanics?
Absolutely
for
not.
Americans? And you're
absolutely
saying
not.
It's inclusive.
It's inclusive.
How can you discriminate?
No, you can't discriminate. But one of the things that we do, there are some programs that are specifically for Latinos. And an example of that is the WIC program, Women, Infant, and Children, where we teach Latina women that are pregnant how to breastfeed, how to pump, how to breastfeed for a longer period of time, and the importance of breastfeeding, and the economics of breastfeeding. That program we do in Spanish and Spanish alone, because it's for non-English speakers, because WIC partners with other community centers to provide that program in English to other communities. That's one of the programs that we do totally in Spanish. Now, in our early development center, which starts at 6 weeks to 4-year-olds, there we have a mixture. We have African-American children, Anglo children, and Latino children. What we did was, first of all, we're star level 5. So that's the highest level you can get in the state. We are top quality, top-notch, early development or preschool program that you can get in a preschool setting in the state of Delaware.
And it's not rated internally, it's actually rated through the state.
Oh,
level.
Honey, they yes. come in there and they give you we have 8 classrooms and they put 8 numbers. And you have to pick 3 randomly selected classrooms that these people come in and they're there all day long evaluating. But one of the things that we implemented 3 or 4 years ago was dual language. So when a kid comes in at 6 weeks, 1-year-old or 2-year-old, it's Spanish language immersion. So those kids are learning Spanish from the minute they come in. When they turn 3, they're promoted to upstairs. Then we do bilingual, English and Spanish. We do English in the morning and Spanish in the afternoon, and we do both for the 3- and 4-year-olds. For the little ones, it's totally Spanish. We immerse them in Spanish. And you should hear some of these kids. It's unbelievable.
So, eso tiene que ser algo que te levanta un poquito, llegar al centro latino. Cualquier persona puede entrar al centro latino, sea blanco, sea afroamericano, sean hispanos, no importa de qué cultura llegan. Ellos entran y pueden recibir la mayoría de los servicios del centro latino. So, lo que ella está aplicando es maravilloso, digo yo, porque algo así es rated a un nivel 5 para los niños. Mm-hmm. Y entonces, como empezaron a dar los servicios para el centro latino, la comunidad hispana, cuando tú recibiste el centro latino en 1994, ¿no? Mm-hmm. Empezó algo para hacer advocacy, no sé cómo decir eso en español, para la comunidad y ser una voz para la comunidad hispana, pero ha llegado a una etapa que ahora los servicios son para todo.
Todo el mundo.
Para todo el mundo.
Hay algunos programas que solamente los dedicamos a los latinos porque se hacen en español,
sí.
Porque tenemos que ser realísticos. Hay muchos miembros de nuestra comunidad que no hablan inglés.
Y lo necesitan.
Que no entienden inglés y necesitan estos programas.
Qué bien.
¿Y qué estaba diciendo sobre el programa para
bilingüe.
Los niños?
El programa bilingüe para los niños.
But la otra cosa es we do expeditionary learning. Are you familiar with Upper Bound?
Sí.
Expeditionary learning is a specific framework to teach children deep learning. For example, the 4-year-olds, They have expeditions, and their expedition is on transportation. So these four-year-olds learned everything there was needed to know about transportation. Walking, bicycle, train, the whole bit. What is transportation? How does it take you around? And one of the things that they had to do was do a case study. The question was, how do the Latin American Community Center staff arrive at the center? So the four-year-olds with their little notebook and the little tallies, they had a picture of a bike, a picture of a person walking, a picture of a train, and a picture of something else, and they would go around and ask you, ¿Cómo usted llega a Centro Latino? Ah, yo manejo mi auto, car. And then they did that evaluation.
En español y en inglés.
En español y en inglés. Entonces regresaron al salón de la clase, y en el salón de clase they did a chart. How many people came walking, cuántos venían en el carro, cuántos llegaban en el tren, cuánta gente lo traían.
And that's the model of what they serve at the LACC under, you know, with the expeditionary learning. Is expeditionary learning really just follows a model that you're not just talking, you're actually giving them examples and doing. So
doing.
Expeditionary learning has been really successful in the LACC with the early development and beyond, because it goes all the way up. Y sobre el programa, para que la comunidad hispana entienda un poquito, sobre el programa de Delaware Stars, y tienen cinco estrellas. Explica un poquito en español, si puede, sobre cómo ese proceso y cómo pueden llegar a esa etapa del Centro Latino. Que mucha gente tienen el programa y tienen el Rated 5, pero muchos de ellos no son bilingües. Y ustedes ofrecen los dos.
Y Expeditionary Learning. No hay ningún otro centro
que lo ofrezca.
De preescolar que ofrece Dual Language y Expeditionary Learning. Nosotros somos los únicos. I mean, está la Academia Antonio Alonso, pero la Academia Antonio Alonso
es una escuela formal.
Es una escuela formal y fue parte del Centro Latino también, que el Centro Latino fue la que formó la Academia Antonio Alonso, que también es Expeditionary Learning and Dual Language.
So los programas
para que los niños de 4 años que terminan en el centro puedan seguir hacia la academia y siguen ese estudio.
So de 6 semanas de nacido, ¿no?
6 semanas.
Hasta los 4 años. Es un segmento de entendimiento y de preescolar que están. Entonces, ¿cuáles otros edades? ¿Cuáles son los otros?
Pues entonces tenemos antes y después de la escuela, que también somos una estrella 4, porque es bien difícil mantener la estrella 5, porque una de las cosas que ellos piden es las maestras tienen que tener su título. Ahí no se cuida niño, ahí se educa niño. Hay una gran diferencia entre cuidar niño y educar niños. O sea, las maestras tienen que tener su título y su entrenamiento. El equipo que está en el salón de clase tiene que ser específicamente para esa edad de desarrollo. Las lecciones de instrucción tienen que estar bien puestas, bien hechas. Hay un sinnúmero de metas que ellos miden para ver si este programa es un nivel 5.
Y para que sepan todos, bilingüe quiere decir que los niños están aprendiendo en inglés y en español. Todo lo que están aprendiendo es en inglés y el español, no. Sí. Dual language.
Yep.
Los dos.
So, los niños que no saben hablar español, aprenden español. Y los que no saben hablar inglés, aprenden inglés.
So what she's saying is that the kids who don't speak Spanish at the LACC, if they're enrolled in a program, if they don't speak Spanish, they're learning Spanish. And if they don't speak English, they're learning Spanish.
They're learning English, vice versa.
And as they continue, every lesson that they get is in
English and Spanish.
So truly, it's the best way if you're going to do bilingual education.
Truly, truly. We have two teachers. Tenemos dos maestras. Nos gusta tener dos maestras, que las dos sean bilingües, pero algunas veces no es posible. So si no podemos tener las dos maestras that are both bilingual, then we have one teacher that's bilingual or Spanish speaking and the other one that's English speaking. But you have to have that partnership there. It's not an easy program to run. It's very expensive. And let me tell you, one of the things that's happening today, and I'm going to say it in English, and I'll say it in Spanish too, is the economy. The economy in the state of Delaware, when it comes to supporting nonprofits, is
the pits.
It's heartbreaking.
Yeah.
Heartbreaking. El dinero efectivo es como imposible.
And even the grants are harder to be, they offer grants, but they're even harder to get accessible and accessibility to it.
Well, not only that, but the kind of compliance that you have to have, the compliance, the paperwork there. I mean, you spend so much time in compliance and paperwork that you don't have time to go out and raise monies. I need some operating dollars, I do.
Yeah.
I need money to pay the rent, the light, you know, to buy
pay
gas,
the bills.
Pay the bills. You know, it's very difficult. It's been one of the most difficult years in the 22 years that I've been there. This has been the most difficult.
Wow.
To raise funds.
Y considerando con todos los fondos que están entrando, que son manejados federal o el estado, lo que sea, para operar el Centro Latino se necesita los fondos y para que entiendan un poquito, ¿a cuántas personas ustedes le sirven en el Centro Latino? Que están ayudando, no solamente en la ciudad de Wilmington, pero la mayoría vienen hasta del estado, bajando hasta, tú sabes, de Sussex o Kent, para buscar servicios sobre el Centro Latinoamericano. So, ¿cuántas personas son que ustedes están sirviendo anualmente?
Nosotros hemos evaluado eso y nosotros tocamos la vida de más de 25 mil personas al año. En una manera u otra. En una manera u otra.
¿Ese número está creciendo?
Pues seguro que está creciendo. Si los latinos estamos a 800 mil, no. 80,000.
83,000 aquí en el estado de
Delaware. So as India was asking, how many people do you typically serve? And is that number
wrong? We touch the lives in a yearly basis. About 25,000 to 30,000 people a year in one way or another, whether through direct service to the Early Development Center, whether it's through the family support services, because we have a food closet, we have, you know, we help people with clothes, we tenemos ropa, comida, le ayudamos a las personas a entrar a la computadora y registrarse para el cuidado de salud, you know, we help people navigate the health care system so they can get health care. Just so many different programs across the age spectrum. We have Los Jardines, which was uno de mis proyectos más favoritos y el primer proyecto que se llevó a cabo cuando yo entré al Centro Latino fueron Los Jardines. En Los Jardines es un edificio para ancianos. No pueden ser solamente latinos, pero la mayoría son latinos, donde los ancianos pobrecitos, pobres, de 62 años o más, pueden vivir sin tener que pagar la mayoría de sus entradas en renta o lo que sea. So the Los Jardines was one of my first projects, because the viejitos, you got to take care of your old people.
So over 25,000 people.
25,000 people a year.
The number's growing. And it goes from 6 week old all the way up to the senior community.
Well, Doña Berta tiene 97 años. She's 99.
Wow. And she's a volunteer there, right?
Yeah,
Los Jardines, they come and they volunteer. She also incorporates the seniors in the Los Jardines, which is the facility that was opened up for the lower income to offset their financial monthly, you know, finances and everything else to help the community. Their seniors come back into the LACC and work and volunteer in the early development programs that they have there.
Los Abuelos
so
program.
There, it's a layer of all the people you service.
Intergenerational program. One of the things that the staff did last year, which I thought was pretty interesting, and I didn't find out until the end, because I don't find out about good things. But what they had the seniors and the preschool work together to do the centerpieces for the open house.
So it goes from, like, you know, infants on up to senior citizens. And you were saying the senior citizen program, so-called Los Jardines, that was a pet project?
Okay. That was my first project.
And yeah. Favorite one.
My favorite. Because you got to take care of your old people. You know how we are. we don't put our seniors in the home.
Yeah, the Hispanic community likes to keep them close to home.
Yeah, we keep them home.
Yeah. ¿Qué clase de presencia ustedes tienen en las páginas sociales? ¿Tienen una página del
internet.
Website, internet? ¿Qué,
todo.
¿Qué clase
todo
de
eso,
tiene?
Todo eso.
¿Y qué es el website del Centro Latino?
¿Cuál es? www.thelatincenter.org. TheLatinCenter.org.
www.thelatincenter.org. And it's the same thing on social media, right? On Facebook?
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah, we have Facebook. Twitter, I don't know how to Twitter, but they do. The staff Twitters.
Hey, that's what staff are for, right? You
know, like, I don't know. I want to learn how to Twitter. I really do.
I don't Twitter either. I don't think it's supposed to be Twitter. I want to learn how to tweet. I think that's what it's called.
It. Yeah. See, I don't even know what it's called.
Well, now
you know. And that's you have to have that kind of online presence because we're living amidst a high-tech backdrop. You know, it's the modern digital era, and you're going to reach people that way.
Well, one of the things that we partner with Comcast, I have a board member that is a senior executive at Comcast, and one of the things that we do is we teach computer literacy, so that. If our community does not have computers at home, they can come to the center and use the computers there. We teach them, you know, how to log in, how to create their email account, how to navigate, how to search the web. So that's digital literacy is an addition to English as a second language that we teach. And we also do the civics class, where we teach the 100 questions that people have to learn in order to become a citizen of the United States. We do a lot. People don't realize the amount of services that we provide in the community.
So, hablando
siempre
de los
están ready para criticar, pero
siempre no saben y entienden. Por eso estamos aquí hoy. Pero háblanos, no hablaste sobre los programas de early development, de los ancianos que están en la comunidad, que están recibiendo programas sobre el servicio del Centro Latino, pero háblanos sobre otros programas que están bajo del Centro Latino, de Social Work, Mental Health. ¿Cuáles otros programas hay para ofrecerle a la comunidad hispana? O a la comunidad en punto.
I've organized the center into two legs. The first leg is the lifelong learning. And lifelong learning starts with the Early Development Center. Then it has the youth services, and the youth services include the Leadership Academy for students in the summer camp, and the before and after school care, the evening enrichment, computer literacy for kids, the credit recovery for kids that cannot function in a regular high school and need maybe two credits or one credit to graduate from high school, and they can come to the center and do that. And then the next one is the adult learning, which is ESL, computer literacy for adults, and civics. That's that leg.
So díganos en español.
Okay.
Ahora para que entiendan un poquito.
So, el centro, pero déjame decirte, let me tell you about the other leg. The other leg is the Life Empowerment Program. And the Life Empowerment Program has family support services and advocacy and prevention. And the reason we have advocacy and prevention is because we need to advocate for our people. The people that cannot speak for themselves need a voice out there speaking for them. I'll tell you in English. I mean in Spanish. So tenemos dos categorías en el Centro Latino. Mm-hmm. Primero es el aprendizaje de vida entera, que está la preescolar y los servicios para los jóvenes que son de campamento de verano, campamento de liderazgo para los niños en la escuela mediana. Niños que necesitan terminar el cuarto año, que necesitan dos o tres créditos, pueden venir y tomar esos créditos en el centro. Entonces también tenemos la educación para los adultos, que es inglés como segundo idioma, aprendizaje de la computadora y cómo tomar el examen cívico para tomar el examen para la tarjeta de ser ciudadano. Entonces, en el otro pie está los servicios de familia, que son enseñándole a las mujeres cómo darle el pecho a los bebés, e enseñarle a ellas también cómo leerle a los niños en la matriz. Tenemos el closet de comida, el closet de ropa, cómo llenar papeles para tener acceso al cuidado de salud,
sí.
Healthcare, Y también tenemos el y no sé cómo se dice advocacy. I'm going to have to learn that. How do you say advocacy?
Advocacy.
¿No estás seguro?
Hay que buscar esa palabra. Sí. Pero es donde nosotros estamos alrededor de una mesa donde se hacen las decisiones que impactan a nuestra comunidad. Y tomamos parte del concilio del gobernador, the Hispanic Commission. Estamos en diferentes concilios o grupos que se unen para el beneficio de la comunidad, para que la voz latina sea proveada en cualquier sitio donde están el resto de las voces. Así que el centro está organizado.
También, fuera de los programas que están ofreciendo, ustedes hacen mucho, como tú dices, la palabra advocacy. We're going to look it up,
I'm
right? You
Google.
Can look it up while you do that.
I'm going to Google advocacy.
El Centro Latino hace mucho advocacy, and she's going to find the right word for that in Spanish. Para fuera de los programas, para que las cosas se hagan leyes también, para promover, tú sabes, el bien de la comunidad, para seguir hacia adelante. Háblanos sobre alguna de las cosas que ustedes están haciendo sobre advocacy. Fuera de los programas para promover cualquier programa o algo que está pasando en la comunidad que ustedes están detrás de eso. Ustedes hacen mucho con NCLR y cosas así. Háblanos sobre eso un poquito.
Bueno, te voy a hablar de dos. Hacemos muchas cosas, pero dos en particular. Primero fue la carta de manejar. Porque nosotros, en unión al concilio del gobernador, the Governor's Commission, nos dimos cuenta que nuestra comunidad, especialmente la comunidad que no está documentada, no podía tener acceso, no podía tomar la licencia para manejar legalmente. Eso estaba manejando sin seguro y sin licencia. So, se tomó 3 años, pero logramos que el estado de Delaware le ofreciera una tarjeta de manejar. Un privilegio de manejar, una tarjeta de privilegio de manejar. No es una licencia de manejar, pero es una tarjeta de privilegio
para conducir. Que lo ayuda también a buscar trabajo. O sea,
lo ayuda a buscar trabajo, pero no lo puede usar para identificarte como la persona que eres. Pero para poder tomar la tarjeta de manejar, tienes que llevar prueba que tú eres tú. ¿Me entiendes?
Sí, claro. So, ustedes fueron un equipo del Centro Latino que estuvieron detrás de esa ley.
Una voz fuerte. Estuvimos en el task group, en el task force. Yo creo que esa reunión se llevó a cabo a lo largo de un año.
Y ahora existe.
Ahora existe. Pero
eso fue desde mucho enero trabajo. Del año pasado, ahora existe, ¿no?
Existe, pero eso fue mucho trabajo para convencer muchos de los legisladores que esto era un beneficio para la comunidad entera, porque teniendo personas que manejan sin tener el conocimiento de las leyes de la carretera, es un peligro o un public health, ¿cómo se dice public health?
Public safety?
It's a public safety issue. It's a health issue.
Right.
When people don't know the rules of the road, so it is a public health issue for people to be driving in our roads next to you and your kids, not knowing the rules.
Maria is talking about the driving privileges.
The driving privilege card, yeah.
And can you just talk a little bit about how the LACC got involved in that movement?
Because they don't just have programs. They also do a lot of advocacy, and this is one of the things explaining.
Right. Well, one of the things that we are part of the governor's Hispanic Commission, mm-hmm. and as part of the Hispanic Commission, in the commission itself, we look for areas where our community is lacking, where we can support our community. And as part as the commission, and part of the LACC and other people, it wasn't just the LACC, it was a huge task force. And we had police officers and from different areas, state troopers, the captains, the colonels, and what have you. But that was important, because if I'm driving down the street with my grandchild, I want to make sure that you know how to yield. You know what that means.
Good luck in Delaware.
You know what that means. But the other piece that I'm very proud of is voting registration and voting rights.
Ah.
And one of the things that we did at the center is we had the elections department come and train everyone that connects with a client. So if you are a client and you come in for services, mm-hmm. the very first thing that we ask is, are you registered to vote? And as such, because Delaware is very strict on how they register people to vote. They are very controlling. You just can't go online and register. You have to be a trained registrar in order to register people to vote. Hmm. So every single case manager or every single advocate, every single prevention specialist that works at the center is trained on how to be a voter registrar. So they're able to register people to vote. And I think that's important because if you don't vote, if you don't register to vote and you don't vote, you don't count.
So that's just a few examples.
Just a few examples.
En español también estaba hablando del advocacy, pero también los programas registrándose para hacer el voto.
Yeah.
Háblanos un poquito sobre eso.
Una de las cosas más importantes en este país y en otros países es el privilegio o la obligación de votar. De votar por las personas que te van a representar en la legislatura. So, lo que nosotros hacemos en el Centro Latino, traímos el estado de Delaware que traineara a todas las personas que estén en comunicación con los clientes. So, cuando el cliente entra por primera vez, lo primero que se le pregunta es, ¿está registrado para votar? Y si no, déjame registrarte para votar.
Sí.
Bueno, tenemos tiempo para una más pregunta antes de un descanso. Y hace mucho tiempo que ha sido la jefa del Centro Latino. Díganos, por favor, ¿cuál es el secreto?
El secreto de estar en el Centro Latino mucho tiempo, bueno, hay dos secretos. Primero, no cojas cosas personal, porque la gente está bien rápido para criticar, pero para ayudar, Segundo, no cojas nada personal. Segundo, es que esto no es de mí. This isn't about me. Esto no es de María Matos. Esto no es de cómo hacer María Matos la famosa. No, esto no es para mí. This has nothing to do with me. This is not about me. This is about our kids, our families, our community, our seniors, our schools.
We're saying, what is the secret to having been with the LACC as the executive director, president, CEO for 22 years? What is your secret?
The passion to make sure that my community is not taken advantage of. So when you hear somebody say, oh, Maria Marta, she was, it's because she heard that you were taking advantage of the Latino community. So I get very upset when I hear people taking advantage of our community in whatever way. But I think the secret is to not make it about you and not take it personal. Make it about the community. This isn't about you. It's not all about you. And third is surround yourself with people that are smarter than you.
That's very smart.
That's the secret.
Like that's what the presidents do, the good ones.
Like someone who can do Twitter, right?
Yeah.
I'm not social media savvy.
Seriously,
you're
a president and CEO of a company. Why are you going to bring people around you that know less than you? No, you want to know, you want people that surround you that compliment what you don't know, and nobody knows
that. Careful, you sound like President Reagan.
I do?
Yeah.
I liked Reagan.
So
I thought Reagan was very smart.
Yeah.
I do.
India, you want to take us to a break and we'll be right back?
Yeah, aquí estamos otra vez con María Mato, la presidente del Centro Latinoamericano, y Antonio Pablo. Vamos a coger un receso para Newcastle County TV, NCCDE, bajo el condado de Newcastle, con Thomas P. Gordon. Ya mismo volvemos con nosotros otra vez.
Keep it tuned, NCCTV. We'll be right back right after this short break. We are talking with Maria Matos, president and CEO of the LACC. All right, we are back here at the Hispanic Hour, La Hora Hispana. I'm Tony Prado with my co-host, India Colon, and we are here with our special guest, Maria Matos, the president and CEO of the LACC in Wilmington. And, you know, I was thinking during the break, Maria, Is it easier in some ways after all those years running the LACC, you know, compared to in the early days? But at the same time, is it harder in some ways?
I would say that it's gotten harder only because the rhetoric that is happening at a national level against Latinos is getting deeper and deeper. So when you have, I don't want to call them names, but when you have people that are demonizing the Latino community or the Mexican community, it is difficult to serve because you have gatekeepers. And those gatekeepers are the ones that have the keys to the gates. And if they have those same sentiments that are going across this country, it is difficult to get operating funds or funds to run programs or, you know, funds to pay the lights. So this has been one of the most difficult years in the 22 years that I've been there that I've had in raising funds.
So they say with great powers comes greater responsibility. So that's pretty much what you're saying. You've grown, you're serving so many people, the number of people you're growing, and you know, you would think it gets a little bit easier, but with the more people you service, the more programs and services you offer, it gets harder and harder to, you know, eliminate that rhetoric that you're referring to. So, but you keep doing it.
I keep doing it. So we need to make sure that our children are the future. And we need to make sure that they're ready. They're ready to pay my Social Security and your Social Security. And if we don't educate them, who are going to be the leaders of the future?
So en el Centro Latino, lo que está explicando es que estamos preguntando en inglés, ¿es más difícil? ¿Te sientes que es más difícil o más fácil estando ahí ahora 22 años, hoy, en el Centro Latino? ¿Te sientes que el trabajo ha sido más fácil o se está poniendo más difícil día a día?
Como te dije en inglés, se ha puesto un poquito más difícil porque hay tantas voces nacional que hablan, que no hablan bien de la comunidad latina, que lo que tiran allá afuera son mentiras, que la comunidad latina viene aquí a tomar ventaja o a vivir a las costillas de otros. Sí. So, es difícil porque las personas que mantienen la llave de los portones para el dinero donde se necesita para operar.
La oportunidad que están ahí.
No es tan fácil como era anteriormente.
Claro.
Pero hay que seguir para adelante porque el futuro de este país es el latino y el afroamericano.
So, you know, we've noticed that for many years now you've had strong relationships, you know, with elected officials, the government officials, like whether it's Governor Markell or County Executive Thomas P. Gordon. How much of the job is made up of that, you know, keeping in contact with you know, government officials?
My personal job?
Yeah.
I would say half.
Wow, that's a
lot.
They
got the money. So I think it's important to have those relationships. And I don't pull a punch, you know, and they know me. They know that when I speak with them, I'm speaking the truth. I don't have a hidden agenda. And what they hear is what I feel and what I think. And a lot of public service, because I don't like to call them politicians. You know why I don't like to call them politicians? Because these are public service, public servants. And for you to serve your community at that capacity, because let me tell you, it's damn if you do and damn if you don't.
It's not an easy job.
It's not an easy job. And for a person,
but it's necessary.
It's necessary.
Especially with you as a nonprofit.
It's necessary. I think it's important that we recognize that it's not about the power, but it's about the service that they provided to the community. So me, I hold their feet to the fire. And they know it. And when I see something that it's not going to be beneficial for our community, I tell them about it. You know, for example, when they wanted to pass the English-only bill, why? You know, when they didn't want to pass DACA, they wanted to prevent students from attending Delaware colleges, living here on a in-state tuition. You know, And I went in and spoke at Leg Hall, and I told them, these kids have been here since they were born. They've pledged allegiance to this country, you know. So my job is to advocate and defend the Latino voice and the voice of those that are voiceless, that can't stand in Leg Hall and look at the Speaker of the House and say the necessary things that you need to say.
Bueno, también estamos hablando sobre las personas que están en el mundo político y cómo tú tienes que trabajar y cómo cuánto tiempo tú tienes que coger sobre de tu día, del año, en tu trabajo para hacer estas relaciones con los políticos y los que están sirviendo en la comunidad como las voces principales en el estado, federal, en el condado, en la ciudad. Mm-hmm. ¿Cómo ellos son parte de lo que hace mover el Centro Latino y con lo que tú haces todos los días ahí?
Bueno, personalmente, medio tiempo, la mitad del tiempo mío es estableciendo relaciones con personas que están en posiciones políticas o en posiciones donde ellos controlan donde se parte el no quiero decir bizcocho porque eso. ¿Dónde se parte el dinero?
El dinero financiero del Estado.
¿O
sí.
¿Cuáles son las leyes que se van a llevar a cabo? Porque yo personalmente tengo que estar pendiente. Si esa ley pasa, ¿qué es el impacto que va a tener en nuestra comunidad?
Claro.
Y si ese impacto va a ser negativo, entonces yo tengo que tomar una voz e ir y hablar. Espérate un momentito, vamos a hablar sobre qué son las consecuencias que esto va a traer si esa ley pasa.
Claro.
Yeah, la mayoría del tiempo es el servicio a la comunidad.
Sí.
Yeah. ¿Y el Centro Latino se queda en la ciudad o se va a mover?
Mucha gente está preguntando, ¿tú crees que el Centro Latino se va a mover, se va a quedar en el mismo lugar? Ahí es donde empezó.
Déjame decirte una cosa. Los otros días, yo creo que fue el 6 de noviembre, yo estaba saliendo del edificio en la 3 y Harrison,
sí.
Y hubo un tiroteo. Y si yo hubiera estado allí como dos minutos o dos segundos más antes, yo hubiera entrado a los mismos tiroteos. So, la ciudad tiene que tomar acción, porque si no toma acción, si las cosas se quedan como están, todos los días alguien lo mata en la ciudad. Hay un tiroteo. Lo que sea, la limpieza es horrible, el alcalde no está ahí encima de lo que está sucediendo. So, si la ciudad no toma acción, no solamente el Centro Latino va a desaparecer, pero van a desaparecer todos los otros negocios. Y yo pienso que la acción hay que tomarla ahora mismo, porque si no, Wilmington se va a convertir en un Camden, New Jersey. Déjame decirte, yo no sé si ustedes han ido a Camden, New Jersey, sí. Pero Camden, New Jersey se quedó sin nada, sin casa, sin gente, sin dinero, sin servicio, sin negocios. So, ese es el camino.
Pero la intención es mantener el Centro Latino donde empezó, donde la familia tuya, donde todos los que trabajaron, la intención es mejorar la ciudad de Wilmington.
Esa es la intención.
Y echarlo para adelante para que el Centro Latino pueda seguir haciendo los programas que siempre le ha traído a la comunidad.
Bueno, la mayoría de las personas que llegan al Centro Latino caminan de la área donde está el centro, pero si todo el mundo que participa en el centro no llega al centro porque tienen terror o tienen miedo, no pueden andar, o la ciudad
se hace difícil.
So, si vamos a mantener ese servicio, hay que llevar el servicio donde está la gente.
Sí, claro, claro. So, we were asking, a lot of people always said, you know, the LACC has been there for so many years, and with everything that's going on and everything else, you know, does the LACC intend to stay there? Do you have plans of relocating? Tell us a little bit in English so that we know where the LACC, location-wise, is intending to be for the community.
I don't think it's the intention of the LACC and the board of directors and I, we have not discussed moving. But my personal feelings, and I've talked to my board chair and to other board members about this, the city needs to take action. You know, the fact that, that children are not safe walking to the center, or do not feel safe walking to the center, or they perceive that the what is perceived now of the city of Wilmington, mm-hmm. you walk in there, you could die because of so many shootings. And it does it appears that, that no one really cares if the city survives. You know, I remember back in 1999 when I was when the Latin Kings were first beginning to show face. You know, I remember talking to the mayor back then and the chief of police. And I remember like if it was today, and I was telling them, you know, we're gonna end up being a Camden, New Jersey if we're not careful. And I don't know if you've been to Camden, but Camden has nothing. I mean, it's coming back now, but Camden had nothing. If the businesses move out, if people do not want to live there, if the houses become deteriorated where they're falling apart, if no one wants to buy there, and it continues to deteriorate, then what's the sense of having a community center? So you have to take it to where the people are, or the people that need it. So the city needs to take the bull by the horn and move.
Y bueno, y con eso, el Centro Latino tiene varios edificios que van bajo el Centro Latino. ¿Hay planificaciones para traer más edificios para el Centro Latino para seguir moviendo y expanding? How do you say expanding?
Expandiendo. Bueno, a mí me gustaría expandir el servicio de preescolar, porque los estudios enseñan que si el niño, especialmente el niño pobre, tiene un comienzo en educación temprana, una temprana edad, la posibilidad que este niño pueda leer para el tercer grado es más grande que el niño que no va a una escuela preescolar.
Sí.
Y lo que sucede y los estudios, tú puedes sacar cualquier estudio que tú quieras y puedes ver que los niños tienen que saber leer cuando llegan al tercer grado. Porque después del tercer grado, ellos leen para aprender. No están aprendiendo a leer, no. Ellos leen para aprender. Y si tú no sabes leer, desde preescolar hasta el tercer grado, tú estás aprendiendo a leer. Después del tercer grado, tú estás leyendo para aprender. Y si tú no sabes leer, tú no vas
a
aprender.
Se quedan atrás, sí. Se quedan atrás.
Es importante. So, me gustaría construir un edificio a cruzar de la calle, porque ahí tengo un terreno, para expandir los servicios preescolar para los niños. Vos debes de tener 200 niños, me gustaría tener 400 niños.
Y hablamos sobre la cafetería del Centro Latino, eso es, no sé si tú has comido ahí, Antonio, pero me imagino que mucha gente han comido ahí de un punto a otro, si no fuera a visitar o uno de los niños. La comida que ellos le sirven a los niños no es algo del lunchbox.
No.
Eso es todo auténtico, cocinado ahí, muchas cosas auténticas, arroz, pollo, ellos comen de todo. Desayuno, almuerzo, y también tienen el 3 o'clock, 3:30 servicio que es para los after school programs y todo también, que ellos están normalmente haciendo y también quiere expandir ese edificio.
La cocina,
¿no?
la cocina es bien chiquita.
Es muy pequeña para servirle. ¿Cuántos niños durante el campamento?
Bueno, cuando yo empecé en el Centro Latino, la cocina servía como a eso de 54 o 57 niños. Ahora tenemos más de 250. Le llevamos comida a la Luz. Y llevamos comida a Oberlin en Newark. Y ahora vamos a, cuando la Academia Antonio Alonso se mude para Valley Mill Plaza, que es aquí en la 141, también vamos a servir comida allí después de la escuela para los niños.
Expansión para Early Development Programs y para la cafetería,
es necesario.
Ya lo sabe.
So, in English, have you tried to undergo any recent capital projects, you know, any kind of expansion? And if so, has it been difficult?
Well, it's been difficult because the space that I have to expand is very tight. And it according to the funders that I went to, said it was not cost effective. To me, anything that would help a poor child is cost effective, but to them, they got the money. Yeah. It wasn't cost effective, it was too costly per child to build in that piece of land. So,
You're talking about the old bakery.
Where that bakery was, yeah. those four houses there. So that's where I wanted to remove that old police mini station, because I have like 29 kids there, 29 four-year-olds. But I wanted to expand over and build up, so instead of 29, I could have 139 kids and provide the same kind of services and the same kind of five-level, star-level quality program that we provide across the street in the main building.
In the spirit of Maria Matos, if you settle for good and okay, that's where you're going to stay. You're going for the next level.
For excellence.
And that's just going to keep growing. We'll see the expansions. We know it.
Yeah. And switching gears a little bit, I've noticed throughout the years that it seems as though the local media outlets have you on speed dial. You know, the News Journal, WDEL.
Something happened in the Hispanic community.
Earlier, if something's going on, they're going to hear from you. And I think the local media knows that. And is that a role that you welcome or no? Like, can you talk about that?
It's kind of difficult.
I do welcome it. I just don't want people to think that I feel that I am the voice and the only voice of the Latinos, because I'm not. I don't know. Yeah. I'm not be all, done all of the Latino community. I do have my own personal opinions. I am 65 years old. I've been there. I saw you coming, saw you going. So, you know, I've been there and back. So the reason they have me on speed dial is because I do know what's going on in the community.
Or you find out.
Or I find out. You know, to be aware of where your community is, of who the community leaders are, of who the upcoming community leaders are, what's going on in the community. It's important, and they know that I know. But I also don't take it as Miss Almighty, because I do not know everything.
But the LACC is, you know, in a foundation, there is a pillar, there is a foundation, whereas the central resource link to anything that might be happening in the Hispanic community, and they don't know, they tend to go out and find out. Because I'm sure you've probably gotten many things that might happen in the Hispanic community, those either complaints or frustrations, because they quickly associate it to the LACC, so the media is quickly going to gravitate to you, and you don't just serve as the advocate to, you know, understand what's happening, but you also help advocate for the communities that they might refer to in the media.
Absolutely.
And you clear it up, getting them in contact with the right people. So you are a central location for
everybody. We're the hub. We're the hub.
Excuse me. You've gotten better at it over the years too, because I remember I was looking at videos of her early on in the media, and her Spanish has significantly
improved.
Significantly improved as well. So yeah, that's always fun.
When you grow up in this country, and the studies show it, that after the second and third generation, our kids forget their Spanish. And it's sad. It really is sad.
Y la comunidad de las noticias, ellos rápido te llaman para cualquier cosa, para hacerlo en español. Cualquier cosa que tiene que ver con la comunidad hispana, ellos rápido dicen, María Mato tiene que saber. El número favorito es para María Mato, vamos a llamarla. ¿Cómo ha recibido esa posición como el public speaker on behalf of like the Hispanic community, que normalmente van donde ti primero, o al centro latino?
Well,
y a veces los confunden.
It is what it is, ¿verdad? Es lo que es.
Sí.
Alguien tiene que hablar por la comunidad, o con la comunidad, o por la comunidad. So, tiene que ser alguien que tenga la pasión, la compasión de nuestra comunidad.
So, sí, claro.
I'll take it.
Yeah. Speaking of...
Well, we need leaders. We need young people. No, por eso el liderato del joven es importante. Porque nosotros no vamos a durar aquí. I mean, papi se fue los otros días. Y todas las personas que yo tengo 65 años. Maybe I have 10 more years, maybe 20. So you got to train the young people that are coming along. That's why cuando yo veo personas como ustedes.
20 more.
Cuando yo veo este liderato, a mí me da mucha alegría. Se me alegra mucho el corazón. especialmente a este muchacho que yo lo lo conozco desde, bueno, y a ti también.
Bueno, yo vivía al cruzar de la calle de tu papá. Papá me cogía a mí y decía, India, ella para la casa, que tu papá te esperan. Yeah, yeah, right across the street.
So, me da mucho, mucho placer. Se me alegra mucho el corazón de ver a la a los jóvenes latinos involucrados en la comunidad.
Gracias. Y en la comunidad, está hablando sobre el leadership de los jóvenes que ustedes ofrecen, un Summer Leadership Program, que es algo nuevo, ¿no?
Sí, lo hemos llevado a cabo 3 años, porque nosotros tenemos un campamento de verano para los niños de kinder a sexto grado. Entonces, los de séptimo, octavo y noveno grado ya están un poquito más avanzados para estar con los niños en campamento, más maduro. So, aquí nosotros, este programa cómo levantar conciencia de ellos mismos, cómo ellos analizarse ellos mismos, that self-awareness, esa conciencia personal, autodisciplina, porque a esa edad son muy rápidos para seguir al amigo o a la amiga. Sí.
So, ustedes lo ponen en posición, el grado 6, 7 y 8.
6, 7, 8 y 9.
Durante el campamento de verano. Y se enfocan en ponerlo en posiciones que puedan ellos mismos hacer decisiones.
Ellos,
enseñarle
cómo tener autoestima, cómo tener disciplina propia, cómo comunicarse efectivamente, en la importancia de terminar la escuela y seguir hacia adelante al colegio. ¿Qué es lo que es un colegio? Lo llevamos a un viaje a la Universidad de Delaware para que ellos vean el campus de la universidad.
So tell us a little bit about that summer leadership, because I know that's something you really want to talk about.
Los estudiantes,
the community knew about that.
Yeah, I'll tell them. Los estudiantes que asisten a este campamento. The students who attend this camp will be learning how to become our new generations of leaders. Not just here at the LACC, but in the community as well. And we have the 3 C's, community, career, and oh my God, what's the third one? What's the third one? I forgot the third one. That's what happens when you get old.
We'll pretend it's culture.
No, it's not. It's community, career, and college.
College, very good.
So the community is, we're teaching them the importance of community service, of giving back, because that's a learned behavior. That's not a behavior that instantly becomes part of you. It is a learned behavior. So community service. The next one is college. What it is? So how does it feel? What is it to go to college? What do you need to do? How important is it? Yeah. And the next one is career. What does it take to be
the director of communications,
to do your job?
Antonio.
You know. Yeah. What does it take? What did you do? Why
a lot
did
of hard
you
work.
Yeah, but what made you become this? So to start teaching them or to start training them to think, because I don't remember people telling me, well, what are you going to be when you grow up? You know, are you going to go to college? No. So we start instilling in them that college is a must. Thinking about yourself, self-discipline, self-motivation, control, personal growth, leadership, community involvement. All this is building leaders in the community for the future.
Well, it's been a very good interview with the great Maria Matos.
Oh,
thank you for coming in
so
today.
Sweet.
It's really
thank
great
you.
To see you. You know, those are all our questions. Was there anything else that you wanted to add? You know, eso es todo. ¿Tiene más que añadir esta entrevista?
Servicio de migración.
Oh, sí, quería estar segura que de anunciar que hemos comenzado un nuevo programa, y es el programa de servicios inmigratorios para ayudar a las personas a llenar los formularios que es necesario para ver si lo que ellos necesitan para estar en este país legalmente. So, tenemos ese servicio. Sí hay un costo porque es bastante carito, pero es menos de lo que van a pagar en otro sitio. So, ese es un nuevo programa, Immigration Services, new
Wonderful.
Program.
All right, well.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you. I love you both. You know, I saw you when you were like little babies.
We love you too.
I love you a lot to be interviewed by two great people.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, it was a pleasure having you here today. So with that, that'll take us to the end of this show.
Oh.
And for County Executive Thomas P. Gordon, this is Tony Prado with my co-host India Colon for the Hispanic Hour, La Hora Hispana. We've been interviewing Maria Matos from the LACC. I want to thank you for watching NCCTV, your source for local news and information on Newcastle County, Delaware. And India, please take it away.
Muchas gracias por estar con nosotros en el quinto segmento de La Hora Hispana aquí bajo el condado de Newcastle, Thomas P. Gordon, aquí con Antonio Prado. Y muchas gracias, fue un placer con María Mato del Centro Latinoamericano, trayéndole toda la información a al condado de Newcastle, y seguimos para adelante, ¿no?
Sí, que lo pase bien.